follow the new shastra of standing up and waving the book about and showing it off and saying that it's officially launched like a grand ship. Shall we do that? Especially with a title like Ancestral Affairs, and they truly are affairs, so he's not being polite. Question which I thought would work either at the very beginning or at the end, but you never know about the end. They might be that things in 10 minutes. So I'm going to ask right in the beginning, especially for the young people here, in this age of super specialists, you know, tell us what it's been like to do such a range of things. You know, from being a police officer to writing poetry, A, but also to move from one genre to the other. You know, all of us fiction writers would love to be poets, but it's sort of like humanities students wanting to do science, you'll never make it. Whereas it's most unfair, poets can turn around and write novels. So, plays, poetry, novels, tell us about this kind of contemporary Indian Renaissance man.
Thank you, Githa. Firstly, thanks for, you know, coming across and sharing this, if I may say. I think a lot depends upon your family. My father was a professor of English. He had thousands of books. He'd been to England from 1914 to 1921. 7 years, and he brought about, we had about 2,000 to 3,000 books. It's one of the regrets of my life that I lost most of them. I was transferred year to year. You can't lug all that baggage with you. So, cricket and literature were a part of my blood. And in those days, if you were in the Punjab, what job could you aspire to? So I studied for 3 days for the IPS when I was in the fifth year. 3 days exactly, on the 14th, 57th. I finished my fifth year MA paper. And 3 days later, NN Bora, we were all college saw me off to the station so that I could go to Cambridge and appear in an exam. I couldn't be bothered. And once you got into the police, you got in. That's it. My eldest brothers were caught in the partition and they didn't make much of their lives. So one had to struggle from bread and butter. And what was the professor's salary? My father retired in 675. He had a pension, in 1945 he retired, and he had a pension of 200 rupees. So, one has struggled, I don't want to make much of it. But one got along, one took a job, and I never regretted getting into the police. And much later I find that my compensatory mechanisms must have been working somewhere or the other. I went in for literature and I avoided drama and I avoided fiction to start with. I said, I'm going to be just a poet and nothing else. If that answers your question, you understand.
Interesting. We really must make it a requirement that all the aspiring policemen in India also do a course in poetry, maybe. It must. About the book, before you speak to us about the book and read from it, what I found very interesting is that whenever people write from the standpoint of a community, and we've had several writers who've written in very interesting ways about the Parsi community. Here, there is something much more specific as well. There is the texture, of course, of the Parsi family and all the aunts and, you know, the eccentric extended family. But there is also a father and a son and certain universals which come through very powerfully. And also, one more point I want to ask you. I find it very interesting that when Parsi, the Parsi point of view, especially around partition time, there's a kind of insider-outsider feeling. A recurrent sentence that the father uses is, I didn't want to get into all of this. I was thinking about Sisyphus, I scanned the man as well. In a way, looking at the madness, yet being a minority community that has learned survival in all kinds of ways. So, two questions. One, of course, is about that blending of a specific community with a historical time, and this insider-outsider.
The insider-outsider would be me, because I normally look at things very objectively. But the character who is writing, because in this novel I have just two voices, either the father spoke or the son spoke, and a first person, no third person narrative at all. The omniscient author never intruded, because that had happened in my first novel and I got the stick from some people. One critic said there are four voices. There were not four voices, there were three. But she was bad in arithmetic, Pakistan rather acceding to them. And they were the religion of the ruler, the religion of the majority of the people, and thirdly, geographical contiguity. And I lived through that period in Junagadh as a child. So, and we were in the palace. My father was the tutor and guardian to the prince. So, and the prince lived in our house, literally. And as I said yesterday with Antara, the first day my father took over, he found about a dozen or 20 servants sleeping on the floor in the bedroom of the prince. So he said, out you go, all of you, and he will sleep alone. You know, I'm just telling you the kind of feudal life they had. And if they went for shikar, they took their car. There were no jeeps. Jeeps hadn't come in 1945, in Junagadh. They were war disposal, as you know. And they would go over fields, a rice field or a wheat field, they wouldn't care. That was feudalism for me.
And it comes out very vividly, and I'm not surprised to hear that there's a kind of memoirish base to that. And maybe we can come back to the elements of the memoir, but really first I think you should introduce the book and read from it so that the audience knows what we're talking about.
As could be put to an attorney at law, agent means His Highness, needed a direct answer, no fudging. Your Highness, states have to deal with the Indian government, which will take charge of all aspects of administration. There can't be 500 smaller countries in the belly of one large country. Not a word was said after that meeting. Sorry. Not a word. The meeting ended. I left wondering whether I would ever be summoned again to the quasi-royal presence of the Nawab. There is also marital discord, and it starts from a visit to Paris for which son's wife, Serene, his father, has paid the airfare. And they went to Paris, and after hardly a fortnight, he was summoned back because he got this particular job. And he meets a Turkish gentleman called Suleyman Yalmaz, who will come later in the novel, because he is attached to Hyderabad, and there is a there is an intrigue going on between Hyderabad and Junagar. We were a bit amazed. This man in western suits, his boot tops always shining, drinking wine by the bottle, whiskey by the half bottle, and yet strike in his views. How does whiskey tell with religion, I asked him one evening. He had been thrown out of Turkey after, and his family, after Kamal Atatürk had taken over Turkey in 1923 or 24. And he answered, without doubt, he said. And whiskey has its own passion, I asked. Without doubt, he said. And we both laughed and clinked glasses. It was not his politics I wanted to talk about. It was the poetry in the man. He had spent time on the Black Sea. His consonants were soft as his stories. Quote, I'm quoting the man, I've seen the fugitive quail migrating over the eastern coast of the Black Sea in August. They head south in droves as August ends. The air scissored with their cries beats as they descend on the coastal flats. They know the flats and the flats know them, but the birds are tired and their cries sound like mini gasps. Some are so exhausted they can't even give voice to their fatigue. Clouds of quail and other small birds move in as winter in the north proclaims its first signs of arrival, though the grass has hardly turned white as yet. Bird shadows darken the ground, their wing flaps hiss, pairs get separated, the male does not know where its mate is. They are just too exhausted to bother. Night will cover them like a shroud, and it's only after dawn that they will forage for worms and their mates. They have escaped the mist and cold, brittle as crushed ice, the landscape white with frost, air dark with snow. They have escaped winter, but not the winter of the hawks. For it's also the migrating season for falcons. Cold is democratic, and so hawks also have to move south. These are the strong-winged sparrowhawks, the ones who can change course suddenly in mid-career, dart to the left, and despite the momentum, claw to the right. They do not come in great numbers. They hunt in pairs. Even their shadows are a study in solitude as they skim the earth for mice and rabbits. I'm skipping a paragraph. There you have it, a bird drift of quail, a fall of falcons. And when this man comes in with his intrigue, Bharucha reminds him in Junagar that I still remember your conversation about the quail and the falcons. And Suleiman Yalmaz says, you mistook me, I was for the falcons. Can I read a small passage, may I? This is the sun. And the sun is a bit of a, it's not a vagrant, but he is not a steady guy, if I may say so. His name is Rohintan. And his chapter starts with, I just read a part of it. Sun, 1955. It was a bad day in office. First thing in the morning, this telegram from Dad. Sam Bharucha believed in the telegraph, saved him the bother of writing a letter to his son, and the telegram starts. Barely 2 years after your disgraceful expulsion, get news, dash, from newspaper, dash, you are defending in a defamation suit. Plaintiff is your editor and boss, your ashamed dad. Sweeter missive, no son received from be father ever. And it goes on. And I'll talk about the defamation soon for just a minute. The lawyer on the other side in the suit went on and on. And then he ended by saying, "And your honor, it is this venerable political commentator, literature and editor, respected in the city, rather India-wide, whom the defendant is called a two paisa worth man, though paisa ka aadmi." At this man, the son immediately gets a vice president. "Your honor, I never called Mr. Chatterjee a though paisa ka aadmi. I called him a char paisa ka, a four paisa worth guy." There was a titter in the court. A lot of my fellow Fourth Estate washouts were present merely to see the fun. The judge got annoyed. He addressed Rastogi, his lawyer. "Tell your client to keep quiet and not interrupt the learned counsel for the plaintiff." Then he looked daggers at me. "Your honor, this is just a correction. The learned counsel is misleading the court. He is harming the value that I put on his client." This time, no tears, laughter rang out, and it goes on. One small thing. This fellow is in, goes to Lawrence College, Mumbai, as a student, as a schoolboy. This is very autobiographical, because my brother went to Lawrence College, Mumbai, which was called Korabelli in those days by the others, by the locals, if I may say so. I never used the word natives incident, which some writers are very fond of using. And within a day or two of my arrival at the school, as people called it, the byline of the vice, which had an impact possibly. Within a day or two of my arrival, I was accosted by an English boy, his face pimpled, beetroot red. "You into sand rocking?" I didn't catch the words, and the accent was way out of my ken. "These Britishers need to learn how to pronounce English," I thought. "From us, you piece of brown shit, are you into sand rocking?" I asked. "What? What did you say?" He socked me. I hit him back. He was quicker and stronger and bigger and gave me a piss. Next time I was asked the same question by a Tommy's son, I let go first. He was amazed, and again there was a fight and he got a beating. Then one morning the boy who had beat the shit out of me, his name I learned was Keats, got hold of me. "Why all these fights, kid? Why don't you give a straight answer? What answer do they want? Whether you sang wrong or no?" "What do you mean?" He looked at me, disbelieving me. With great patience he asked, "They want to know if you wipe your blue with a rock each time you bloody piddle." "Why the hell should I?" "So you don't?" "Of course I don't." "Well, tell them that instead of losing your teeth in them needless fights." And he adds, "All these Mormon kids do. I mean, they give a good rub to their innocence with a rock once they're pissed." And I'll read one last
We have 5 minutes. Yeah. Are there object questions? I think
are you through with
some time for questions.
Are you?
Let me then ask about the missing women. And I'm glad you read the third extract, because that is the sort of thing which goes in quite seamlessly into the larger political happenings, and very much this texture of what it was like to live then, and you know, what the sort of things that happen to people, what do people believe about others and so on. But I wanted to ask you about the two affairs, father and son. The son's not an affair, I mean, it's actually marriage, but it's more like an affair. And though they are supposedly different, they both have strangely, dysfunctional relationships with women they apparently love. Do you want to also talk about the troublesome fact that the first one, actually, the father has an affair with the English woman, what does that mean in the 40s?
I'll answer that. Thank you for asking me. I thought of it initially, the first 50 or 60 or 100 pages, almost as a morality thing. Here's the constitutional lawyer who is sticking by his faith in the law and in the advice he gives, whether he loses his job or he doesn't. He couldn't be bothered. And the mirror image is he falls in love with a British woman called Claire, whose husband has died. And he is looking after the papers, and he gets very sympathetic. And one day, at the moment this happens, the sexual liaison, he tells his wife, and they separate. So there are parallels in morality, if that's what we call it, and morality on at the other end. So does that answer your question? The son has a very, and Claire, she has, her husband was a shipping magnate in Birawal. Birawal was a very fine port in Junagadh. There are no Gujaratis here, otherwise, there you are. You are everywhere, I mean, it's, except possibly the moon.
Not Gujaratis are Bengalis, we always have Bengalis in
it. Parsis were 10 million, they would have also been everywhere. Okay. What was I saying? I'm sorry, I lost my train. The son has a bad accident, and I don't want to speak about the whole plot. You know why. It would be unfair on the book. They are in Kanpur. He and his fiancée are in the medical college. There's another Parsi family there. And he gets expelled. His roommate dies. They've had a drunken binge. And, well, I don't want to go into the details of the plot. And he leaves. He has to leave Kanpur. And later she marries into another Parsi family, which is very much there in Kanpur. And as far as the father is concerned, Claire returns to England after the Indian government rose into Junagadh, and the British resident and the British political agent from Rajkot go away. And the Britishers leave from Junagadh. Even the schools were run by the Britishers. I remember my headmistress was Miss Bolton, and the lady who took me in class was Miss Morenis, a very tall lady, and I think she was from Goa. I hope that
really, I'm going to invite questions, and do I see any raised hands? Because I let's all compete. Do you want questions from the audience? Do you want one troublesome question from me? Or do you want your Romana question? democratic audience. I would use your right to vote.
Wherever you go, I mean, you say you're an Indian. I mean, Tata will pull out of the cupboard. But everybody, I live and work in Goa. I haven't been working here for 28 years. They say, oh, but you are Indian, but you are not like other Indians. You're not, you know, kind of thing. So linked to that, the question I want to ask you, Mr. Daruwalla, is how much of your Parsiness affects what you write? How much of your writing is affected?
Your disapproval censors, but I'm going to say that really we should not be asking is it does being a Gujarati affect what you write, but you know the language you know and so forth, of course affects you, but she wants to know whether your being a Parsi affects what you write. If you don't mind, as somebody who knows your work, may I twist that question, will you forgive
me?
What
I mean, so out of the character, the kind of morality, even in the fact that I haven't read the book, I will, you said your protagonist goes home and tells his wife that he's having an affair. It's somehow very, to me, it somehow seems very Parsi.
Oh, I don't know about that. It just seems like an extraordinary man. But may I ask my troublesome question? Which is that, you know, in a way, this is always a question one has about what makes a minority assimilate, and I'm using all these charged words within quotation marks, please, assimilate so successfully, again, within quotes, and of course there's that cliche story of the sugar and the milk and so on. There's also the cliche explanation of class, and you know, so if you can afford it, you. I think it's important to talk about both the ways in which there's been a genuine kind of, what shall I say, Indianization, to stretch the word Indian, not just the assimilated, but also the troublesome aspect of being in between, in a way being in the Goravelli, though being Indian. I'm sorry, it is a troublesome question, and I'm asking just because I think these are sort of curious questions we should ask to understand the nature of minorities.
You know, these questions are not touched upon in the book.
No.
It's not. Number one. Number two. I lived in the north all my life, okay, and I even learned to speak Gujarati after I got married, because my wife refused to speak either in English or in Hindi to start with, so that I could pick up Gujarati. My mother could teach me Gujarati. So that way I am an odd man out as far as the Parsi community is concerned. And people used to, throughout my youth, I mean in 12 books or 11 books of poetry and a novel and short story, there was nothing about the Parsis except one poem.
Yeah.
And then I came out with Fire Altar, which is totally Persian, went back to the roots. And I came out with this novel. But this novel had more to do with Junagadh, where I initially cited the family. And then a novel has its own propulsion, and the plot takes off, the characters take off. And as a small community, the Parsis also live among themselves, let me be very frank. Though they assimilate with their surroundings, they were traders in every hill station, you know, in Dharamsala, in Ranikhet, in Nainital, all over. But if they are in Mumbai or in a place in Gujarat, they stick to themselves like all minorities do. Whether you can call them Jewish ghettos, they are not ghettos, but in Valsad, there is a Parsi Wada, there is a Mota Parsi Wada and a Nana Parsi Wada. You see, so the Parsi is here.
And also Khushro Bagh in Bombay.
Absolutely. Actually, Keki, I think you've given us the perfect answer. and you write to it through your texts and your life, which is why the clique mentality, the ghetto mentality exists in all communities for various reasons, minorities or otherwise, that the very fact that there are so many of us who are hybrids in terms of language, in terms of perspective, in terms of choice of life, I think that actually gives us the solution to cliques and ghettos overwhelming us. Would you want to have the last word? They tell me time is up, but I think you should have the last word. Would you like to end with a paragraph or say something about the book?
I really don't know whether I need the last word here. I don't think I have anything special.
Look carefully. There is a modest writer, a rare thing.